Do 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 do. What's up, everybody? Day 287, making Songbringer. Today is gonna be a very theoretical day. Well, let's start out with at least. Let me show you what happened with the Giants vending machine. This thing turned out pretty well. I like this. You can go select an item. Oops. Looks like sound might be awful in a second. Oh, energy saver. Sound. Headphones. There we go. All right. Is it working now? I'm streaming, Ben. Thank you. You're so orange. Yeah, so here's the Giants vending machine. Here's how it turned out. Purchase an item. Falls off the wall like that. Yeah, so I'm happy with that. So today's goal is a bit crazy. It's kind of crazy theoretical because the whole point of today is to make it so that the levels use a totally different algorithm for how their keys work. But I want to maintain something with the way the game already works. The game is really nice about how it... it creates backtracking. So let me show what I'm talking about. Like here is the map for dungeon one in this world, no beer. There's times in the dungeons, not particularly this one, but there's sometimes you'll have to backtrack. Like you'll get key one, for example, and you get into section two. And in section two, you actually have to backtrack. Here, this is actually a pretty good example right here. You go key one, and then key two is backwards a little bit. So I want to maintain that. That's pretty good. But I want to... But I want keys to basically be used only once. So right now, the way the game works is you have the way the keys work is that they're color coded, just like Doom. You get red keys, which open all the red doors. You get let's jump right into this level that we're talking about here with this map right here. Yeah. So if I'm to go to God mode, run around. Yeah, here's one door already. Right? I already have the key for this. I've already played through this dungeon. So I already have the red key, and that's why this door opens up. If all the enemies are dead in that room, I can go back out. So yeah, and this is actually a great example here too, because we have a red door here, a blue door there. That's great if you want a Doom style game. Which It's worked pretty well for this game so far, but I want to take a risk here and go with the old school Zelda style, where I want to at least experiment and try out using keys only once. So rather than having keys that open up doors, like a blue key that opens up all the blue doors, it would be a single use key that opens up only one door at a time. What's up, Pete and Wally? Yeah, I'm just considering a new key system. So this is what's trickiest about all this is creating the code, creating the dungeon generation code so it works better, or works like that. Because it changes everything. It totally changes the whole algorithm. So I have an idea. I've kind of got some pseudo code idea here for how this is going to work. And I want to test this idea out. So I'm going to do this on the live stream. I normally don't do this theoretical stuff on the live stream. What's up, Protito? Because it makes me nervous. I'm trying to do something really, really heady and then talk at the same time. So let's see if this is even possible. So here's the pseudo algorithm for how I would try and go about changing this from a Doom style key system, color coded, to a single use key system. What's up, Proton Gaming? Right, different levels could still keep the blue red. Yeah, and this is once again, this is an experiment. This might take me 2 or 3 days to get this experiment done, but if this experiment fails and I decide that the game was more fun with the color-coded key system, then I can go back. But I think this is I have an in, my intuition says that this could make the game more fun by having single-use keys because it puts the control the power back to the player. As a player, you have a choice. Do I use this key? Do I go find another key? Where should I use this key? It puts more smarts into your strategy of how you actually traverse a dungeon. So I think this could be really, really fun. So I'm gonna test out this whole pseudo code by modifying what the dungeon would look like if I use this algorithm. So I'm gonna see if this works. So the way this pseudo code works is like this. Only the most critical door is locked. And every dungeon has a different critical path. For example, this dungeon here has a critical path and starts at the entrance, goes here, goes there, 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 and then there to the boss. Do I use graphs? Technically, yes. Yep. There's a dungeon, or is there like the dungeon system already uses its own graph, basically. The graph has different rooms. Different rooms have doors which lead to other rooms. So technically, this is all a graph, yes. And by graph, we're talking about the mathematical graph here. Or I mean the whatever kind of graph. I'm trying to whatever. Graphs confuse me sometimes. There's one, there's like the drawing kind of graphs. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the tree style graphs. So, okay, only the most critical door is locked. So for example, if we were walking this dungeon right here, and this is the critical path, it goes there, 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 there. We would only lock this door right here, this number one door. And then the next part of the algorithm would go like this. All other locked doors are made secret. So instead of this one being a locked door, it would be a secret door. So this would be a secret path. This also would be a secret path. And that would change the way that that where this item is placed. This is item two is inside this locked door here. That would no longer be like that. Yeah, edges and nodes style graphs, exactly. Yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna walk through, I'm gonna modify this text of this dungeon based on this algorithm. So only the most critical locked door is locked. This is the critical path. That's gonna be locked. Now this is gonna become secret. Whatever. Here's one that's also secret. This is gonna totally change this dungeon. Because this key is no longer gonna be there. And also this corridor. Kind of crazy. I don't know. I wonder what this would be. Yeah, so only that door is locked for number one. For number two, it would be the most critical to that one. Oh wait, here's another one. That's also a secret path. Interesting. This is really going to change the way the whole game runs. I wonder if this will even Man, this is intriguing. It's very intriguing. Okay, so for lock number two, this is the critical path right here. So this one's gonna be kept alive, and this one's gonna become secret. This one's gonna become secret. These two are gonna become secret. Which also changes this. Okay, so the alternative to all this is this whole pseudo idea. It would be to instead of to consider always placing new always placing areas with similar key levels nearby each other, or else randomly placing them without caring about their key level. All right, so that's kind of a janky idea right there. There's a lot of holes in that idea, so I gotta just putting that one on the back burner there. Pete and Wally, item triggers can also act as keys to mix up certain zones. Yes, of course. And okay, so I should clarify that. In this game, there's two types of keys, and there's also another, there's a third type. There's the three types of keys. There's regular keys, which just open doors. Secondly, there's switches. So switches are things you can go and activate. Like this number eight is actually a switch. You go here, you fight a bunch of enemies, you activate this switch, and that opens up your boss door. So yeah, there's regular keys, there's switches, and there's also gates. Gates are things that require an item to cross that. So like I think that's what you mean by item triggers. You need to have an item to be able to cross that gate. So there's three ways you can do that. And that third way is also puzzly. So you know you can add puzzles, which or actually switches would be puzzles. So yeah. So there's keys, there's switches slash puzzles, and then there's gates which require an item. A Fool's Duty. What's the title reference? I'm talking about Doom. Doom uses a color-coded key system, like right now. Yeah, so right now Songbringer uses a color-coded door system. So all the doors that are red open up if you have the red key card. All the doors that are blue open up if you have the blue key card. But Zelda is different. Zelda 1 at least is where you would get one single key, and that one key would open up only one door. So it puts power back in the player's hands. It's your choice as a player. Where do I use this key? What door should I use this key on? Am I messing up by using this key here? You know, it adds a lot of intrigue and excitement to how you choose to traverse a dungeon. So I want to experiment and try that out. What's up, Scottish Pizza? Okay, so this is totally gonna change this, but let's move on with this and see if this will work. So I think we've changed all the keys now in this dungeon. Now we need to change the way the items are placed. Items and keys. So items are not placed in areas with only secret doors. Or actually, this would need to be a little bit smarter. Or down paths that are behind secret doors. So yeah. So if this area, for example, if there's a secret door right here, and this is becomes you know into there, and then there's if there was another room beyond that, that also would need to not have any critical items in there. This is critical items. Critical items are not placed in areas with only secret doors. So, you know, non-critical items could be. So, for example, you could put a bomb container back here or something else that's not critical. Yeah, Scottish Pizza, what I'm working on? One-time keys, basically. Yeah. Okay, so let's go on with this and take it to the next step. Critical items are not placed in areas with only secret doors. So, for example, that would be okay because it just locks you inside a secret door. But this and this, these are totally bad now. These need to be placed somewhere else. So here's where you get an item. This is where you get key number one. That's fine. You get key number one here. You can go over here, open up key door number one. And so door number, yeah, key number two would need to be placed anywhere in this whole section that is not behind a secret path. And yeah, that's all. So we couldn't put key number two there. We would need to put key number two anywhere else randomly, but as long as it's not behind a secret door. So it could be here. Could be there. Could be here. But that would be kind of cheesy. Oh, hey, wait, here's another door number one. That would actually be a secret path. Now this whole section is kind of crazy. Minutes till your birthday's over. Right on, man. How you been celebrating? Gosh, this is the one drawback to this whole system is making all these other paths secret. It changes this whole dynamic. This whole thing couldn't have any items right there. Anyways, okay, we need to place key number two. It could be there, could be there, could be there. Okay, this is a non-critical item. This would be okay to place behind a secret door. So let's throw this out here in the middle of the void. Placing key number one right behind another key door, where you would use a key, is kind of cheesy. Though, hopefully not right behind a door. Okay. You just went out to dinner? Cool. Oh no, it's your first day back at school? Well, hey, the one good part about that is you get to celebrate it with people, right? Everyone else was like, "Hey, it's your birthday." Okay, let's say key number two is here. That would work. We could put key number two there. And so you could, and then once again, these keys don't matter which order they're used in. So one and two really don't matter anymore. Wow, this whole, yeah, the one, yeah, this is kind of a drawback in the sense that it puts so much stuff behind these secret doors. So key number, well, yeah, this is key number eight. So I technically, this is a hidden item. This is a hidden item. Hold on, let's put these up here. We got a regular item to place, a hidden item to place, another hidden item to place. We got key number eight to place. And then all these other L's, we can get rid of these L's. These are locked doors, so we can, make that a not locked door. Not locked, not locked. Okay, so the most important next thing to place is the key number 8. Key number 8, which is the switch, would be placed anywhere below anywhere in the whole dungeon, actually, but as long as it's not behind a secret door. So it could be placed here, which would be crazy cheap, would be really cheesy, because it's right by the boss door. Here also, any of this is kind of cheesy to place right here. Yeah, I don't know if I'm liking this algorithm. So far, this has kind of changed the whole dungeon to be not as cool. I mean, you know, there could be a totally different way to generate dungeons. Yeah, because really, the best place to put the key in this dungeon would be there. Or the last key would be there. Oops. Okay, let's keep on going with this algorithm. See how this turns out. There's a regular item, which is this is a critical item. Yeah, that's a critical item, so we need to put that somewhere. It could go there, there, or there. This is so. There needs to be a better way. But yeah, okay. Let's say it's there. These hidden items could be anywhere. Wait, hidden items are more like the map and the compass. They would kind of have to be in all these other places on the critical path. That's all we have. This is possible that there's not, you wouldn't even be able to place all the items. Okay, but yeah, so barely, you're barely able to complete this dungeon. There's tons of secret area it's unused. Like, check this out. Like, you just get to this secret area. If you do find this secret area right here, it leads to nothing. Everything behind this is totally secret. There's no items. I mean, I guess you could put a hidden item there, and that would kind of make it worth it. But not if that hidden item is only meant for this dungeon. So, God, tricky, tricky, tricky. I might not be able to code this today. I might have to think about it more. All right. Let's try another dungeon. Let's try dungeon number 2. Let's see what happens if we do 2 with that whole algorithm. There's got to be a better way, though. There's got to be a better way to make it so the dungeon, the secret door is this first step. All other doors, all the other locked doors are made secret. There's got to be a better way to do that. Yeah. Let's think about that for a second. Let's come up with some ideas that would make it so instead of switching all other doors from being, you know, numbered or color-coded locks to being secret, there's got to be something else that would keep the dungeon more open. Yeah, I guess you would have to make it so. You'd have to make it so all paths. Yeah, all paths behind a certain key level. Oh yeah, I guess that would work. Oh my gosh. Okay, so let me write down a different type of pseudocode. Okay, let's go back to the start. This is what this dungeon number one looks like before anything has happened. This is way more simple. When switching key levels, create a locked door. New key levels can only be placed. Okay, wait, no. New rooms can only be placed. Adjacent to the same key level. That's kind of it. That solves everything. And I guess you would still have some backtracking. So the one worry I had with this idea, this simpler type of dungeon generation algorithm with single-use keys, the one worry I had was that you wouldn't have as much backtracking. In fact, some people wrote in saying how they love the current dungeon generation system. But I think it can be better. But the one thing they loved about it was that you would backtrack. You would be in a certain part of a dungeon, and you would need to go back to another area to use a key or whatever. Where's Bafu? I don't know. What's up, Black Iron? How you doing, man? Oh, it's been a while. How you been? Happy 2016. Yeah, so this could work. This could definitely work. When you switch to key levels, you create a locked door. New rooms can only be placed adjacent to the same key level. However, if you're going to a third key level, oh yeah, so unless a new key level is being switched to. That's what it does. So yeah. So if you would, let's say you were at key level, the first area is key level one. The next areas that you would go to would be key level two. So, but if you kind of created this section that was level one, another section that was level two, the third section could either go near level off of level one or section one or off of section two. So that could possibly be create some backtracking. In fact, you could make it so. You could make it in that case. Ensure the new room is not placed adjacent to the previous key level. If The key level is above 1. If the previous key level. You been good? Really busy at work and school? School's about to start up? Yeah, right on. Good for you, man. What are you studying at school right now? Actually, this is worth trying. This guy could code today. But it would change everything. It's not like I can go and just try out that algorithm by changing the text and everything here. I would actually have to try that out with code. But that would be okay. Oh, and then this secret doors can connect differing key levels. Ah, that changes everything. Criminal justice? Whoa. Cool, man. All right. Should I dive in and try this right now? I guess so, huh? Let's do this. Wizard, I'm heading out to the studio in about a month. Oh, and once it's recorded, I'm going to send it out to my mom's friend. He's a producer. Cool. Good for you, pizza. That's awesome. Okay, I'm going to copy this pseudocode and get right to it. So we're going to start in dungeon.cpp. And yeah, let's get reckless here. The heart of this algorithm is here, the new room placement. New rooms can only be placed adjacent to the same key level unless a new key level is being switched to. When switching key levels, create a locked door. Secret doors can connect different key levels. Yeah. Let's see what happens. So we need to start choosing where to put keys. It's all in this. It's all in here. When it goes and chooses the next room parent, that's it right here. Choose the parent. Wait, what's the difference between choose next room parent and choose next position? All right, pizza. See you, man. Good luck with your studio. Good luck with school. Happy birthday once again. Thanks, man. Hold on, what's the difference between parent? Oh, yeah, so this creates a list of possible rooms. It creates a list of possible rooms and randomly selects one. And that's for the parent, but what's the next position? Oh. Parent room is the room that is the previous room, but next position could be one of three different rooms off of that parent room. So, okay. Yeah, so we're the key to changing this whole algorithm to be this new key system would be to make the next room parent always have to be either the same key level. Okay, so we need to be aware of when we're switching key levels in this next room parent. So How does it know that? Where does it increment the key level again? Oh, here it is. Key level plus plus. Oh yeah, okay. This is the last key level. The big switch. This is where it increments the key level. And then otherwise it's the same key level. We have number of keys. I think there's a current key somewhere. Yeah, key level is the current key. Yeah, okay, so we need to store the last key level. Key level, last key level. Okay, we need to pass that into the next room parent. So we got key level and last key level. So get next room parent, where's that? I'll choose next room parent. Current key level, last key level. Let's get that compiling. Okay, so now we've got the information we need. Wait, let's make sure that's being passed in. Key level, last key level. Okay, so now we've got enough information for this thing to make a wise choice. So this is where it chooses the boss room position and the goal room position. So only possible room is last added because this is boss or goal room. This is where we create a list of possible rooms. This is where all this new magic is going to happen. So it loops over all the current rooms looking for a parent, basically, or possible parents. What's this one here? Rooms.size equals number of rooms minus 3. And this has room. Oh, this is where. Less Doom. What's up, Azarus? Oh, this is it. You're right. Yeah. I know. I still love Doom. I just want it to be a little more Zelda-y with single-use keys. So that's what today's about, single-use keys. I've been rapping for a while now, trying to work out how this algorithm will work. I think I've come up with a solution that will work. Basically, the pseudocode goes like this. When you switch key levels, create a locked door. New rooms can only be placed adjacent to the same key level unless a new key level is being switched to. In that case, ensure the new room is not placed adjacent to the previous key level if the previous key level is above 1. So This sounds, you know, complicated, but really it's actually pretty simple compared to this other idea I had where it was locking doors, only a single door on the critical path, and then making all the other doors secret, which turned out to be a bum idea because it created too much secret paths. Like, check this out. It turned out to be this whole section of this dungeon was all secret. So that idea didn't really work out that well, but I think this idea will. So I'm going to go ahead and experiment and try this out. So this is, let me put some comment here just to make sure I remember what the hell this is doing. This is always place the boss room north of the before boss room. All right, and then this one, if r.keyLevel equals key current level, yeah. How you doing, Azenris? Happy 2016. I think I told you that yesterday, but if I didn't, happy 2016 anyways. Maximus the Greatest. Hey man, quick question. If I want to create a prototype for a project to recruit programmers, would you recommend I go with Unreal or Unity? I want us to have a third-person controller and a spell casting system. It sounds like you have different... my recommendation here. Let me first of all say that Unreal versus Unity, kind of meaningless. Well, no, not necessarily meaningless, but in some senses, it's either one of them is a great choice. Unreal, great engine. Unity, great engine. You know, different languages, one C sharp, one C++. But I think you should clarify what you want to get out of this prototype, right? It seems like you have two different motives here. One is that you want to recruit programmers, and two is that you want to create a certain type of prototype. You want to create a third person controller, spell casting system, and all that. What do you really want? Why are you recruiting programmers, right? So answer all these personal questions you have for clarify what it is that you want. And then it will probably be much easier for you to choose an engine, because either one of them is a great engine. I hope that helps. Okay, so this is where we choose, add possible rooms. Okay. So this is where we want to go and make sure that the key level is the same as the previous. Which is just like that. R.key level, which is the parent room, the possible parent room, is the current level. Or here's where the logic gets a little bit twisty. Or if we're switching key levels, I guess it's not that twisty. Yeah, so if current key level is not equal to last key level, right? So if we're at current key level 2 and the last key level was 1, then it would be okay for us to add this as a possible room. Okay, but yeah, the tricky part of it is this thing where we say if the last key level actually, let's see what happens. This is going to change the entire dungeon generation algorithm, but let's see what this does at first. Here's what I want. I want to create a third-person camera and then make a system where I could play an animation which launches a projectile, a spell system. Basically, what I'm asking is which engine would be faster as someone with no experience to make these things faster? I don't know. I don't know which is faster because I haven't ever used Unreal. I've used Unity and I think it's great, and I know Unreal is great as well. And secondly, I don't know you. I don't know your personal skills. I don't know so I can't answer that question for you. Maybe somebody else here would have a great suggestions for you, but my suggestion would just be this. Go use both engines. Spend at least a few hours with both engines, creating a little bit of that prototype, right? Actually, what I would probably do is spend an entire day on both of those. So I would spend a whole day with Unreal and getting as far as you can, and then spend a whole day with Unity getting as far as you can. And then after those 2 days, you will definitely know which one to choose. So I hope that helps there, man. And then you're only down 2 days doing it. So all right. Yeah, okay, let's see what happens. This is gonna change everything, but let's see. All right. Cool, Maximus. Yeah, and good luck with that, man. Let me know. And it also would be great to know what you end up choosing and why. So if you get to your solution here and you find out which engine you chose, I would love to know. so I can help other people with that. What's up, PMC? Okay, so I guess we can run around in God mode a little bit. So this is a totally different dungeon. But it does look like we're fine. Well, let's look at the overall map actually before I commit to that. Here's the boss. Oh, interesting. Double door there. Okay, so I'm gonna look at the outputted map here. See how that would see how that turned out. Azarus, right on, man. Nice. Cool, Maximus. Right on. Yeah. Always best of luck to everybody's projects. I'm so excited for what you guys are developing. Cause it's cool to be creative and it's fun to connect with people that are also being creative. Okay, so how did this turn out? It put two keys. Oh, I don't like this. So it shouldn't. Okay, so the goal of this whole algorithm is to only put one key, one door that locks per key level. Oh, I think this might have actually connected a further path. Oh, let's turn on verbosity level 2 for the dungeon. Run it again. And now we should get a way more verbose output for how this creates this dungeon. So yeah, anybody that's just joining the stream, today's topic is a very heady, very intellectual subject of how to procedurally generate dungeons with single-use keys as opposed to color-coded keys. So that's about all the description I can give you. Wow, that is a lot of verbose output for sure. Okay. I don't know if I want to see this much verbosity. Yeah, I'm turning that off for a second. That's too much. It's going to overwhelm me. Okay, let's put that back to 1. I think what happened is that it went and it added more doors. There's a phase of the dungeon generator where it adds more doors. Places keys, places items, adds corridors, adds doors, adds a few more doors or whatever. Let's turn that off for a minute. See if we get a different dungeon. So, I mean, it would only have a single key. All right. First of all, let's go undo. Take one more look. Oops. Never mind. Already lost it. Okay, anyways, let's go to dungeon 1, and we should only have, if that worked, then we only have one. Yeah, it did. Look at this. All right, here's the dungeon pure. Before it goes and adds doors, adds secret doors or anything. And look at this. We've got one key, one door right there. We've got this path over here. This might lead to an item or something. It doesn't, but we could rework the dungeon generator. So it's smarter about that to put an item here at the end of this path. But the main point is we've got key number 1, which doesn't, the key numbers are not going to matter in this new system. But anyways, the first key or whatever, a key is here, a door is there, another key is here, another door is here. The switch for the boss room is here. And there's the boss. And you know what? I actually like the way this dungeon looks. This looks like a fun dungeon. So I'm liking this already. Okay, I'm gonna take a quick little break here. I'm gonna just leave the game running. I'll be right back. All right. Feed the cat, yes. Yeah, there's an auto pause. Yeah, why is the map? The map is messed up because I added the same shader as the rest of the whole game, but at a very smaller resolution. It's an accident. Really, what I got to do is rework the map in the bottom left. So, it doesn't use the shader, but it will have some cool lighting. I'm gonna make it so that it's lightest where you are, and then it gets darker and darker away from you. So that's on my list. All right, I'm really excited. This is a really exciting day. I got an idea. Okay, so I'm putting back in the code to link up more doors. So this dungeon right here will have, like, for example, a door would be placed there. A door would be placed there. Some kind of door there as well. Yeah, so that's three more doors it would place there. If they're differing key levels, it's going to make sure they're secret. So it doesn't matter if they're different key levels. It's only going to make it... Oh, here, we can still use this key diff. Yeah. Just use a key. Whenever there's a difference in the key levels, it creates a secret door. If it's the same key level, it will make a normal door. So no secret. All right, let's run that. All right, here we are. Compare these two dungeons. There's that old dungeon. This newer dungeon. Here we go. Here's what this looks like now. Yeah, cool. We did it. So put a secret door here. As you can see, there's no secret door there. So yeah, link that one up. Link this one up with a regular door, which I'm not sure if I like. Ah. Yeah, I guess I do like that. The point of adding more doors into the dungeon is to give it more of an open feeling. And in fact, if you play Zelda 1, there's so much of an open feeling in their dungeons. Like you feel like you have choice everywhere you go. And that's really one of the secrets I want to bake into this game with Songbringer, is to make that choice, to give you the choice of where to go instead of creating linear paths, more of fractal paths. Okay, so we put a secret door there. That works. Okay, let's compare another dungeon. Let's see what happened with dungeon 2. Wow, dungeon 2 is kind of interesting. In fact, let's get rid of the whole. Let's get rid of all this text we don't need. Okay, we got dungeon 2. Right, dungeon 2 over here. There's before, after. Wow, it added so many secret doors. So there is no secret door there, but it added a secret door here. Let's see if that. I'm just gonna kind of walk through each one of these doors that it added, just to make sure that it did put it in a smart place. So yeah, adding a secret door from here to there. Yeah, that's cool actually. So if you're speed running this, and you get to key number 3, which you're gonna need to find somehow, this is awesome. This is really awesome because for speed runners, they would place a bomb right there and get through to get. You wouldn't even need to use key number 3, actually. But you'd still probably pick it up because you're there, unless it was a difficult thing to get. So yeah, key number. This is a really, really cool one right here. Secret door allows you access into this further part of the dungeon, a lot without having to backtrack. Same here. If you get to the route there, it's nice to have this secret door. And here's another secret door, kind of meaningless. I wouldn't waste a bomb there, but better to have a secret door than to have, nothing. Okay, dungeon 3, let's check that one out. Let's follow the critical path as well. 4-1. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Yeah. Entrance, of course. 4, 2. 4, 3. 4, 4, 4, 5. Yeah, of course, the critical path is exactly the same. Will there be any secret doors to dead ends just for treasure? Ah, that's a great idea. That would have to be added. Yes, that's a great idea. Let me add that to this whole. I'm gonna add a totally different item for that. Secret doors that lead to hidden item rooms. Treasure rooms, basically. In fact, yeah. Let me change this. There should be at least one secret treasure room per dungeon. Totally behind a secret door and completely full of awesome loot. Yeah, that'd be sick. It'd be so cool to be running through this and find that or whatever. I love it. Okay, cool. So yeah, that's kind of a separate task, and that's gonna be pretty easy to add on. Just tack on one room per dungeon, put it behind a secret door, add a bunch of treasure in it. Super easy to add that. Okay. So this dungeon, how did it change? How did it change? Interesting that it didn't add a path there. I guess that's because these are both corridors. Oh, and that's a corridor as well. Ah, so it placed corridors before it placed extra doors. I guess that, yeah, that's by design. Oh, you know what? Corridors should never be placed right by other corridors. Let's make that differentiation. So, where's that code to add? Oh, where is it? There, add corridors. This is where we get impossible rooms. Only if a room has two doors, only if it has no flags, only if doors are in a line, only if adjacent rooms are not corridors. So we're going to loop over all the adjacents. There, similar to that code there. So, autoref adjacent. This is the room r.pos plus i. Yeah, that's the adjacent. Okay, if this is a valid room, and we Yeah, so if this is a valid adjacent room. Oh, wait. This is different. This needs to be like this. If this is not a valid adjacent room, we just continue the loop. We just ignore an adjacent room that is does not exist in. And then we make sure, so yeah. If adjacent.flags and k flag corridor, we're going to return negative one. Let me think through that again. So we're looking for possible rooms for making it a corridor. And in this corridor selection of possible rooms, we're looping over the adjacent rooms. We're getting the adjacent room. We're making sure that if it's not a valid room, we continue because we just ignore it. Ignore non-valid adjacent rooms. Disallow adjacent corridor rooms. Okay. Run again. See how that changes. Basically, that should really change this second dungeon a lot. So this has got two corridor rooms right next to each other. It shouldn't be like that. Actually, that should affect level two as well. Level two had two. Oops, that didn't work. Oh, wait a minute. I think this is where I think it already placed. Okay, this is the wrong math. This is the wrong way to do it. Basically, we got to filter this list. After we go and create possible rooms, we want to make sure that there's no possible room which is right next to another one. Okay, so we're gonna call erase elements in the possible. This is gonna be a lambda function. Probably gonna need to capture this. We're taking, what's each element? A room sort. Const room sort ref. Okay, so we're going to erase every element. If it's close to another one, so we need to make a copy. Of the possible, original possible equals possible. Capture original possible, loop over original possible. Why didn't that? I have to capture that by ref. Too many arguments provided a function like macro invocation. What? So I can only pass one argument to this, probably because of the way I wrote this macro. I'm going to recompile that, see if I can have a better macro there for that. Okay, so I'm going to loop over everything in possible and see if their distance is only one. What's a room sort again? Room sort is, sucks. Whenever you're compiling, Xcode just won't let you do any of its awesome autocomplete or whatever. What's up, Valesen? How you doing, man? Room sword's got an R pointer to the room and a float weight. IR pause. I think it's pause. Yeah, pause. All right, I need to check if I've got a sub. If I subtract the two positions, no. I want to do the distance between the two rooms. So if your position dot x minus. What's the oh yeah rs dot pause rs dot r pause dot x. Okay, let's do this a little smarter. We'll do int distance. So yeah, we're returning dis equals 1. Oh no. If dis is 1, return true. Otherwise, return false. Don't erase the element. Okay, I think that's right. Basically, what I'm trying to do here is filter the list of possible rooms so none are adjacent. So we take, we're filtering out the possible array. We are capturing original possible. Let's see if that works so I can do this now. No, I still can't do that. Wow. Oh well, we only need to capture one anyways. So yeah, we got each time this is called, we get the room sort. We loop over all the original possibles. We take the distance between them, which would be the original rooms x minus this given rooms x plus the original rooms y minus this given rooms y. Add those together. So if the distance between the x's is 1, oh, this needs to be fabs or abs. Abs. Yeah, so if that's 0, that'd be the same room. What could happen? If it's 1, that means it's an adjacent room. 2 or more, it's always not going to be an adjacent room. I think that's right. Let's see if that works. Pete and Wally, it should work, right? Thanks for that confirmation. It totally reassures me to have somebody else look at the code and go, yeah, should work. Okay. So let's see. Dungeon 2, Dungeon 3, whatever. Yeah. Okay, it totally changed the way this whole dungeon got generated. It only put one possible corridor room right there. Oh, wait, there's one problem. There's one problem with this algorithm. See, it wanted to put a corridor over these two places, either there or there. But because they're both next to each other, it deleted both of them. Espresso, I live in California, man. Oh, Vailsen, good point. Very good point. Yes, you're totally right. You're totally right about that too. Both those need to be abs. Yeah. That's abs. That's abs. Okay, so what I want to do is essentially instead of like making a copy of the possible array, really what it needs to do is loop over the current possible array every time, which is would be crazy. You used to live in Chino Hills? I live in Oakland. Yeah, so the Bay Area. Where, and it's kind of like, yeah, you miss it? I heard Chino's nice. Yeah. Okay. I don't think we can actually loop over an array while we're deleting elements from it. So I think it is necessary to this original possible thing. But I guess we could delete from original possible. Don't know if this will work or not. Oh yeah, we would need to at least go bool ret equals false, ret equals true, return ret, and then we would need to delete the found entry if necessary. Oh, Vailsen. Yeah, Vailsen just woke up. He's in the land down under. It's very light there. You got lots of light ahead of you. They demolish things? Oh yeah. Used to be a small town. Crazy. It's crazy. It's crazy to think anywhere in the Los Angeles area would be a small town, but it was. It was very, very small town. Am I making two copies? Yeah, you're right, Azarus, I am. So I could actually, yeah. So I guess that is safe, huh? So if I were to go like this and go possible, we should get the exact same results as before. So what I want to do here though is I want to be comparing to the latest erased elements. So in other words, when I erase an element, I want to then go and use that new array or new vector with the erased elements. Good. Yeah, you're right. You're totally right, Azimuth. So this is it chose to put a one there, but it should have put at least one there. Nice. Right on, Belzin. So yeah, I guess I could just delete the found entry from this cop. This is a copy of possible. So it's inside this this lambda function. Oh, I got a better idea. We could just change the room sorts. Distance. So yeah, so if red equals true, oh, we need to make a copy first. Okay, we gotta go backwards here. Auto possible capturing this possible, but first we loop over everything in possible and set its sorting weight. So I dot weight equals 1.0 or whatever. So yeah, we start everything off with a weight of 1, and then if I dot weight is 1, I dot weight equals 0. It doesn't work because it's const, huh? Yeah. So I wonder if that's because this is const, or if this is const. Obviously this is const, huh? Because this, I've used these before, and they're not const. Kind of getting off track here on the stream right now, but this is almost working. So what if I just did this? Like, if I were to try and modify possible 0 dot weight equals 0. Does that work? Should, right? No. Oh, it's read only. Damn it! How do I do this? Oh, capture by reference? Good suggestion. Let's see if that works. Thanks, Azarus. Azarus, the C++ god. Thank you, man. I think that's all we need to do, and then we can just return true here. Make that a little simpler. Okay. Kind of complicated. I just realized that I could probably mix all that into this little loop down here at the bottom anyways. But maybe not. Maybe this is the right way to do it. Oh, it still didn't choose to put a possible path there. Or a corridor. Yeah, I'm going to try this one last way. before I call this all quits on this idea, I just want to make, okay, so while we're choosing places to put the corridor flag, we might as well just measure the distance versus all the possible things. Yeah, we don't even need to worry about that other code there. So looping over everything in the possible array. Oh, we do need this. Okay, we need to be inside that. I think this is easier to easier for me to think of if I do index is less than possible outside there. And here we've got an index. We just want to compare it and see if index works. This is going to be RS. This is just RS. This is going to be underscore RS. How many dungeons have I made? Well, there's 9 dungeons per world. Yeah, so 9 dungeons per world times 300 million worlds. So I guess there's that many dungeons. Is that what you meant? Is that right? Did I answer that question right? Okay, it'd be easier to make this a lambda function as well. So this would be auto can is adjacent. Oh, the art styles. Oh, right. Now there's really only one art style so far that's finished. There's 2 other dungeon styles that have been started. And in the end, there will be 4 main dungeon styles. And then 1 psychedelic dungeon style where 3 of the dungeons will be like that. So essentially there'll be like 5 or 6 different art styles for the dungeons and then 9 different dungeons each. But 3 of the dungeons in each one are going to be totally different than the rest. They're like these psychedelic dungeons that have totally different style. You don't even fight enemies in them really. You there's more mazes where you're totally disoriented and then you find your sword again. You find a new skill. You actually develop a skill like a chi skill. Or whatever, like using your chi to make a shield or whatever. And then you fight 1 boss or 1 mob boss, perhaps, in those dungeons. So they're going to be totally different to try and switch it up and make it more interesting. And they're also like crazy hard to access. They're not crazy hard, but just more secret access to those dungeons. So should add some nice variation to all of it. So that's what I'll be working on the next like few months. That's really my next goal, is to get all the dungeons finished. So let's do this is adjacent function. We need a const vector room sort. Ref. Possible and a const room sort ref current. Or R, RS, whatever. So now we can loop over possible, get the distance between RS and underscore RS. The distance is 1, return true. Otherwise, return false. There. Now it's simpler because we can return from our lambda function. So if is adjacent, possible to RS, continue. Don't choose. Don't choose corridor rooms that are adjacent. Good night, P. Wally. See you, man. Pedro, what's up, man? Welcome to the stream. Hey, guys. Okay, you know what? I just realized this. I just wrote this. And now this is not going to work either because, yeah, you're a mod, man. We all decided as a group yesterday that you should be a mod. You weren't there, but I scrolled through the list and went back to your last comment. And like, Pedro, mod. Also, Boogie's a mod, too. Yeah, Asner is totally. This will have the exact same problem. Yeah, so what I need to do is compare. I need to check, not check the distance, but check to see if an adjacent room also has the flag already. So if dist equals 1, and the room that we're comparing to. What's up, Zanger? Yeah, Pedro, man, it's the least I can do. Thank you for all of your awesome efforts, man, and all the great, everything you've done. Appreciate it. Yeah. Okay, so it's the room that, it's the RS, underscore RS room. So if the underscore RS dot R flags, K flag corridor. It's adjacent. This should be called is adjacent corridor now. What I've been up to today? Today's kind of a really heady concept. I'm trying to change the way the dungeons work to make it more like Zelda, less like Doom. Doom is where you had color keys, you know, so when you got the red key, it opened all the red doors. I want to experiment, you know, I'm not going to commit to this until I try it out and play it and see if it is more fun. But the concept is going more with the Zelda style where you keys are single use. So you, once you get the A key, it's used on a single door and it's done. So that's like the Zelda 1 style. And I think that could make it a lot more fun for players because you get more choice. You get to choose which door you use your key on. You got to be smarter about things. You get to, it's more in your control, under your power, about how to play the game. And I think that could be really be good for people that enjoy this kind of game, you know? So I think this could be fun. I'm going to try it out. It's an experiment, but it is quite a lot of abstract thinking and stuff like that going on. So yeah, not quite as visual of a stream today. So let's see if that works. Keycard should be for a secret ship dungeon level? Cool. But if it's procedurally generated, how will the player know which door to open? That's the trick. That is the trick to how do you procedurally generate a dungeon that works with a single key system? And, you know, I started off the stream with thinking about that. I started with two different ideas. One was making all the current system work, reworking the current system so that everything except for one door was secret. That idea turned out to be kind of bunk because it just changed. It created too many secret paths. And then this other idea I have is when you switch key levels, you create a locked door. And when you go to a new, when you're placing a new room, they only can be placed adjacent to the same key level. And that idea is much more simple and actually turned out to create interesting dungeons. So I'm trying out this idea as we speak. But, you know, great question, right? How the hell do you do this? This is kind of uncharted territory here. I based this whole dungeon generator off of some blog post articles that Tom Coxon wrote. Tom Coxon and his Meta Zelda is a great thing. If anybody's interested in procedurally generated worlds, especially Zelda E worlds, you should check out Tom Coxon's Meta Zelda. So I read some of his articles. I wrote my own system, which is different than his, but kind of based on the same concepts. And one of his things he was wondering in his blog posts was, how do you do a key-based system where you have single-use keys, which is a lot more tricky. So I think this idea could work. Yeah, it did. It worked. Okay, cool. So this corridor now is all set. So like, here's the old way. It placed two corridors right next to each other. Here's the new way. It placed only one corridor there. Why not win? What's the meaning of the title? Because Doom had color-coded keys. Zelda had single-use keys. So the title means to make it less like Doom, where it had color-coded keys, and more like Zelda. Yes, Arcor, yes! Doom! Okay. It didn't quite work how I would want it to. Like, there's a lot more areas that could be corridors here. That could be a corridor. Wait, no, that couldn't be a corridor without added a path. Okay, it added a path afterwards. Let's turn off paths for a second. So I'm gonna go back to where it's generating paths. Or I mean adding extra doors. So let's turn off these extra doors for a second. Doom! Yes! Doom had color-coded keys. Zelda had single-use keys. Songbringer currently has color-coded keys. I'm thinking about changing Songbringer so it has single-use keys. All right, so yeah, here's this dungeon without adding more doors. And this is obviously a great area right there to have a corridor. This also, no, that shouldn't be a corridor, but that could be a corridor. And I'm wondering why it didn't put corridors. Okay, this makes sense. That's not a corridor because that is. Oh, so corridors need to be linked by rooms as well. Yeah, small keys, boss keys, exactly. Every time you see GL anything, I cringe. What do you mean? Yeah, Azimuth, that's a great question. Are keys only specific for the current dungeon? Great question. Great question. I don't know. I don't quite know. I think the math would work out if you let players just go willy-nilly and use keys that they find in one dungeon in a different dungeon. I think the math works out so that would still be possible for them to complete the game. Because if they... Well, no, I guess technically it wouldn't. There might be certain dungeons where you could get into a certain area and you wouldn't have access to another key. So I don't know. That's a great question. I think for now I'll make it so they are specific to the current dungeon as it currently is. What do I use for controller input? I use Oh, yes. SourceForge here. So look for this on Google. OIS SourceForge. It's a cross-platform game controller, basically input system. It can give you mouse controls and keyboard. I basically don't even compile any of its keyboard or mouse stuff. I only use its gamepad stuff. So yeah, Protito, there you go, man. SourceForge OIS. Oh, you don't like OpenGL, huh? You prefer the new one, the Vulkan or whatever? Okay, so what I want is for these to use more corridors. Like that could be. Oh yeah, so let's make it so it's not gonna. It can allow corridors that don't have a door. So if the distance between them is one, and we have a door to it, so rs.r has door to destination rs.r pause. Think that will be right. Yeah, for it loops over every door to see if there's a destination. Yeah. Okay, let's try that. Oh, right. Yeah, it was hard to learn how to code it. Oh, yeah. I hear you, man. OpenGL can be kind of crazy. It's all C based and very. It's like you almost have to have a certain kind of programmer to do OpenGL, you know? Unless you're just a very, very well-versed, awesome programmer and you can do it all, which is rare, you know, it's hard to develop all those kinds of mindsets, I guess. Personally, I don't even touch OpenGL. You know, I use Cocos 2DX. That's why I use a game engine, because I don't want to do as much low-level stuff. I want to do more high-level stuff. I want to make my game cool, not necessarily make a great engine. You know, I'm more about the game versus the game engine. Okay, so this worked. This worked. This now has a corridor there because these are not linked. It can go ahead and it doesn't consider these to be adjacent. So that's great. The last thing though is that there should be one there too. Yeah, there's no reason why that should not be a corridor. It's compatible with, even with your toaster. Yeah, totally. The average user doesn't give a shit. Not at all, dude. People only see the end result. And that's why I want to focus on the end result rather than the, you know. And for some people though, you know, it's great to go create your own game engine because you learn a hell of a lot about games. But is that's when you really got to choose, okay, what do I want to make? Do I want to make a great game or do I want to make a great game engine? You know, those are two great choices, great paths. You can do awesome things with both those. So, okay, it should have, if this is level, I guess let's set a breakpoint. If we're at Z, let's go to add. What's adding corridors? If Z equals 3, set a breakpoint. The low-level C programmers will despise you. I don't care. I don't care if they despise me. I want to make a great game. I don't care if I'm despised by anyone, as long as this game is awesome. Okay, I want to see if this breaks again. Oh, it does. So we got the 3, 4, 5. What the hell? Oh, wow. This is so many different seeds. We gotta let this run for a minute so we get it the right seed. We'll skip the seed because this is a, what this will do is make it so the game doesn't like loop over a bunch of different seeds that don't work. So what world creation succeed with blah 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 blah. I go see put this as the actual seed it uses instantly. And then re-enable this breakpoint. Yeah, totally right. Yeah, if I play that again, yes, okay, we get no more breakpoints. Okay, so now we can step into this method, see what possible rooms are get listed as possible and then chosen. So we're gonna step into add corridors. Now I'm gonna let it run to here. Possible. Here we go. So in this dungeon, we got a possible room. 313. 31 is 1, 2, 3, 3, 1. Yeah, that's definitely a possible room. And it gets chosen too, so that's great. 1, the next one is 3, 2. 3, 2, that also gets chosen. Number 2. Oh, it's probably just max. Oh, it just does it. Oh, that's probably what it is. Okay. I didn't even need to set a breakpoint for all this if I just read the code a little more. The next one is 5, 2, which would have been 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2. Ah. Yeah. So it would definitely be allow a room there if I had just had a higher cap. That's all it was. Let's increase this cap a little bit. So we can have, say, 3 corridors. We got max right now is rooms.size over 9. And it's already ceilinged. So how many rooms we have here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. And this is right now we have 21 over 9. That's 2. If we divided by 7, we would have 3 or even 8. Let's see if we had 21 rooms divided by 8. Yeah. 21 rooms divided by 9. No, that should be 3. That should be ceilinged. Why isn't that working? Rooms outside is 21 over 9 is 2.3 or whatever. CLF. We should have an int max. Yeah, Scottish pizza. Yeah, right? Yeah. No, actually, secretly, I've been wanting to do this for a long time, but I always wait for it to get brought up by the stream. So thank you, stream. Thank you for finally bringing it up. I've been wanting to mod Pedro and Boogie for a long time. Maybe this just needs to be plus one. Let's see what we get now. I don't know, that might be too many. Look at this. Look at this dungeon 9. Really interesting, huh? Okay. So path number 3. Yeah, we got 3 corridors now. And now that I've got three corridors, I kind of think it's too many. Yeah, it is. It's too many. Take off that plus one. But good work. This is actually really great work to have this. This is adjacent corridor and all that working. So now we can go back and keep working on the rest of this algorithm. I'm banning all of you to celebrate. Yesterday, Boogie tried to ban me, and it said, "You cannot ban the whatever." It's funny. We're like, "Can you ban the streamer?" Okay, so now let's see what it looks like with adding in more doors and having these newer, better corridors. Corridors, doors, doors, corridors. What else rhymes with doors? That's a word we're using today. Zanger loves being banned. He's all about it. It's a good thing you can unban just as easy as you can ban, though. I learned the unban command. Slash unban. You got slash unban, slash ban, slash mod. All really easy to execute. Okay, cool. So we have these two corridors. It linked together a door right there. It added a door there and there. Those are both inside the same key level, so they're normal doors. Interesting. Really interesting that it added no secret doors at all to this level. But here we got some secret. Why did it have no secrets in level 3? Yeah, this one's a great example of secret door there, secret door there, secret door there. Awesome secret doors as well, because this is great for speedrunners. Mods are channel hoppers as well as broadcasters. I never knew that. I never knew mods couldn't ban each other. That's good. It's good to know. Wait a second, there's no keys. There's not even any keys in Dungeon 3. No wonder there's no secret doors. What? Oh, of course. Oh, of course. Okay. It's because Dungeon 3 is a special kind of dungeon. This is where the psychedelic dungeon is. It's a different kind of thing. Okay, let's skip that. Let's just go to Dungeon 4 and check this one out. Oh my god, this one is crazy tall. So crazy tall, I can't even fit it on the screen. Oh yeah, I can, barely. So the barely. Okay, so what happened here? We got secret door added there. Here's the key number 3. Let's walk through as a player what this would look like. You start here. You can get to the first key here, which is going to open up this first door there. Ah, okay. So this is a great example of a dungeon which could be more interesting. It could be more interesting by putting its third or fourth key level. It's like it's especially its third key level, not adjacent to its second key level. So that was the stipulation I had here in the pseudo code. This thing right here, this part. This line. In that case, ensure the new room is not placed adjacent to the previous key level if the previous key level is above one. So here's where we gotta add some code, which is gonna make this a reality. So essentially, what it will do to this dungeon here is as soon as we get into this third key level here, key level number 3 should not be placed by key level number 2. I mean, yeah, no, yeah, that's exactly right.
key level 3 should not be placed adjacent to key level 2. So this is key level 2 inside there, 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 there. These four rooms right here are key level 2. This is key level 3 here. And this is key level 4. Okay, so there's four key levels here. Actually, a fifth key level if you count the switch getting you to the boss and all that. But, yeah, so key level 2 or key level 3 should not be attached to level key level 2. It should be attached to key level 1. So that creates a little bit of backtracking, which is what people liked about the old dungeon generation system. So this next stipulation, this next bit of pseudocode is going to make dungeons more interesting. So this is going to totally change the way dungeons are generated, but let's see if it creates a more interesting dungeon floor. We're not really going to be able to compare, but at least we'll be able to look at the new dungeons and see if that kind of worked. So choose next room parent. Here's where it all is. If the current key level is not equal to the last key level, basically, okay, this needs to be a separate logic statement so I can kind of keep it clear. So I'm not sure what to name this just yet, but the logic is, if the last key level is greater than 1, or it might be 0. Yeah, let's see where do these start at. Key level 0. Okay, yeah, so key level 0 is basically level 1. Yeah, so if last key level is greater than 0, and the current key level is the current key level minus 1, or the if this room's key level is the current key level minus 1, then we're going to ignore it. This is previous key level, essentially, right? Last key level is greater than 0, and the current room is the last key level. Or just last key level instead of this current key level minus. Anyways, what this would be is or this and not is previous key level. Okay, I hope I got that logic right. I wonder how I would test this though. How could I? Well, I guess you would look at level. This dungeon should be sort of like the old one. Like it should start off creating this dungeon with E there and the corridor there and the key number 1 there, and then 2 even would be the same. But the third section would be different. All right, gotta try it. Gotta dive in, see if this even works. This is a hard one to test. It's hard to like see if this worked. You're out to bed. All right, man. Good night, man. Bon nuit. Is that right? Did I say that right? Good night. Okay, first thing I need to check is if it failed with salt 0. What? Oh, it failed with that salt. Bonne nuit. I think I said that, hopefully. You know what I mean. Sorry, I'm so bad at French. Okay, I'll turn off the the seed, because that we can't force a seed with this new algorithm. This just that one simple line there changes everything. You've heard worse. All right, man. See you. Good night. All right, cool. World creation succeeded this time with 223. See if that's much different. We got 303 there. Let's compare those. Yeah, 309. Oh, yeah. It actually succeeded with less salt. Awesome. What that means is that it actually created this world easier than it created the other world. So that's a good sign. It's a great sign that we're on the right track here. Okay, let's see next how these dungeons turned out. Whoa, look at dungeon 9. Crazy. What we should see here is the entrance to each dungeon a little more central. Should be the dungeon entrance should be more in the middle. Okay, so dungeon 1 looks like it completely change. Let's see. There's the old dungeon 1. Oh, it's a different world. It's a different world seed. So yeah, there's really no comparison. I can't even look at this old one and say, you know, this should be like that. Okay, well, let's look at this one and see how it turned out. So we would start here as a player playing through. This is the secret door there. Here's the first key. We can get to this room. That's it. We will be stuck in these three rooms right here. So we have access to this first key. It would open up. Oh, check this out. This is a choice. Oh my God, this created a choice. That's so cool. Today, a restaurant near me was offering a beer to each client per goal scored. In two soccer matches? Oh, no. And both matches ended at 6-0? Oh, man. Good thing beer isn't that expensive to the bars. If it's on tap, I mean. Was it tap beer or was it bottled? Couldn't have been bottled. Okay, so are you guys seeing what I'm seeing here? This is sweet because as a player, you can grab key number 1 but go through door number 2. Wait, that might actually create a bad situation in some dungeons. Some dungeons, maybe you go through door number 2. Oh, no, that would be okay. That would be all right because each key level has a key in it or a switch. So the switch would get you on to the end, or basically as a speedrunner, you could grab this first key, go through the second door, skip this whole section where you would get to another key, which would just enable you to get to that same door anyway. So this is great. This creates a faster run for speedrunners. And it still is completable no matter which way you do it. But I'm going to go look through all 9 of these dungeons, or at least as many as I can right now, and see if it does create any kind of not completable situations. Like if I had picked this first key, I think it's going to be okay. But anyways, let's say you didn't take that choice. Let's say you went the other way. And you went to this room and you use this key, you would get inside this level and you would get this second key, and then you can go back over here and use the second key, and then you would go up here in this section, go to the switch, hit that switch, and then open up the boss door complete. All right, We can close this one now. Let go. Let go. All right. Next, Dungeon 2. Can the skippable part have needed items? Great question, Azurus. Yes. Yes, I guess it could. Oh, that's a good point. Yeah, here's the trickiest part about it all. It's how do you place? I guess I could be smarter about how where items are placed. So if I had so far there's really nothing important that it placed. All it did was place another key, but there could have been a critical item there, like the ghost sword or whatever. And the ghost sword is later used in the game to pass over certain gates. So yeah, basically there needs to be one more stipulation in this pseudocode. That critical items cannot be placed in skippable sections. An easy way to do that would be to make it so critical items are always in the last key level, because you're always going to get there. That would be the simplest way to solve this whole problem. So if there is a, yeah, I'd probably start with this solution right here because it's so easy, so simple. Basically, yeah. So it would put if there was a critical I is an item that's I think is critical actually. So item I would have to be in the key section 3. So it would have to be in here, 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 here. Which it already did. It already placed it there. Which I think it might be part of the way the dungeon generator works right now. I think it does put the critical items in the more difficult areas, which just so happen to be the higher key levels. So, but there should be a stipulation in the code that makes sure that this critical item here is always in the last key level. Which kind of makes sense for the dungeon anyways. Okay, let's go on to level 2. You start here, there's a key right next door. I guess it works. Oh, you can open up key number 3. This is another one where you have a choice. So if you, okay, then here's this, I'm glad this happened because this is key number 3, in which would allow you to skip sections 1 and 2. Oh, I came up with an alternate idea. Or else, all... keys that would create skippable sections need to go in lower key level sections. So in other words, key numbers 1 and 2 would be inside this first key section. Okay, I'm just going to keep that in the back of my mind as like two possible solutions to this whole skippable sections problem. Okay, so let's see how this would play out though. Let's say you took key number 1, you opened up door number 3. You would get into, well, it would work because this would get you straight into the last section where you could get the switch and go to the boss. Yeah, thanks Pedro. Thank you, man. Yeah, I'm starting to get really hungry anyways, and I'm starting to think slower. So I do need to call it quits here pretty soon, but I'm going to go through a couple more of these dungeons. Just checking them out. The more I can think and get these thoughts in my head before I go and eat and take a break, the better, because this is really, really heady. If the critical item isn't needed for the specific dungeon, killing the boss could also open up all doors. Oh! That's a good one, Azenris, yeah. Or an alternate way to do that would be that killing the boss gives you all the keys. I guess it is smarter that, yeah. I'm going to write your idea down. It's a great idea. Or else, killing the boss could open up all unopened doors. That is a nice, very beautiful, simple solution as well. As long as you can get to the boss, this is going to work. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. So yeah, this would work. Or let's say you took key number one and you went for door number two. You could still get key number three and then open up either one of these doors. So yes, this dungeon is completable no matter how you do it. Okay, dungeon three. This is a totally different dungeon. This is one of the psychedelic ones, so that's no keys. Okay, dungeon four. Yep, we got a central start point there. Here's key number one. And here's an interesting one, because it added a secret path from the entrance straight to key number four. So as a speedrunner, this could be very interesting to play this one. You could quickly go to this right here, get number key number four. You could bomb again and get to here. Man, there's so many possibilities here in this one. Man, I gotta say, thanks, Azurus, for being on this stream today. It's really, really helpful to have some great ideas and feedback from you today, man. Thank you. Appreciate it. Because this is difficult. This is probably one of the more difficult tasks of this game so far. But so far, I'm really liking it. I'm really liking how this is creating more choice for the player. And it's also creates faster paths for speedrunners too. In some worlds, I guess. Some worlds might not. Okay. So if you grabbed key number one, you could easily go into key section two, grab the third key, which would allow you to get to either the first door. Or you could open the third door, which is kind of meaningless in this one. Oh no, I guess it's not meaningless because you get the fourth key right there. Man, this one's tricky. Where's the fourth door though? I'm not seeing door number oh, there it is. There's door number four. Okay, so if you grab the first key and you opened up you got the second or the third door you could open, which would be very tempting and tantalizing to open either one of these. So here's a totally skippable section. Section two, totally skippable. You could go to section three, which you get key number four. Oh, this is really interesting here, because this third section here where you get key number four, these are secret walls right here. So it seems like that's a dead end, but it's not. It's kind of interesting. As a player, you'd be like, oh, dead end, but you find a key. But really, it's not a dead end. So, okay. Trying to just like break this dungeon. Somehow this it could break. I guess it would be broken, yeah, for all of this, the cases where if you had a critical item here or there. So if you opened up door number two, you get key number three. This is interesting. Key number three here is totally not necessary. Oh, wait, no, that's not true, because there's a secret door there. Ah, so interesting. Man, the possibilities with this new key system are, there's just way more possibilities. Okay. I think this is about it for today's stream. We got a new key system been working on today. Lots of theory, lots of thinking, lots of looking at problems that this would create and trying to solve them before they're even a problem. Whoa. So, yep, that's it for today's stream. Tomorrow I'll be back, same time. And what am I going to be working on tomorrow? I'm not sure exactly. See ya, Azenris. High five, man. Yep, so, see you guys. Have a good one.